नमस्कार। वेलकम टू ज्ञानीज वर्ल्ड। Dear Gnani's World viewers, in episode 2, based on evidence, we came to know that RSS is not loyal to national flag and is loyal to Peshwa's saffron flag. Now, when this episode 3 of season 3, know about the RSS based on Rashtriya Swayamsevak Sangh documents.
Let us see whether RSS is loyal to Indian constitution or not.
Before we continue, do subscribe to our channel and press bell icon for updates.
Dear viewers of Gnani's World, RSS demands promulgation of laws of Manu in place of Indian constitution.
The old RSS dream of promulgating the Manusmriti as fundamental law of the country got impetus in 2004 when Uma Bharti, a seasoned sadhvi of RSS, came to head the state BJP government in Madhya Pradesh. Soon after coming to power, Uma Bharti government promulgated an ordinance on January 23, 2004 banning cow slaughter in the state. The crucial part of this ordinance was that it referred to Manusmriti for justifying this ban. The ordinance read, Manusmriti ranks the slaughter of cow as predator and prescribes heart punishment for him. It was for the first time in the history of free India that commitment to enforce Manusmriti as part of legal setup was announced by any government.
Undoubtedly, if RSS is able to capture political power in India, women and Dalits too will be treated according to the law of Manusmriti. For this, the socio-political scenario of Uttar Pradesh is the best example. Uttar Pradesh tops the list when it comes to the communal incidents, fake encounters and custodial deaths. On an average, 8 women are raped and 30 abducted every day in Uttar Pradesh and is a place where more than 100 FIRs of crime against women are lodged.
Recent sexual assault at 20-year-old Dalit woman from western Uttar Pradesh, Hathras, who was allegedly brutally assaulted and gang raped by 4 caste men from her village, died nearly 2 weeks after the attack. Caste has everything to do with this, as it does with almost every case of rape of Dalit women in at least rural India.
So, dear viewers of Gnani's World, at this point it is our duty to know why RSS wants Manusmriti in place of Indian constitution.
It's true India's legal system bears the burden of several imperial legacies which can be happily discarded, beginning with Section 377 of Indian Penal Code, IPC. A gift of former British masters dating back to 1860, it criminalizes adults engaging in consensual sex against the order of nature, a Victorian phrase that could stretch to include everything other than intercourse that leads to procreation.
We know how the RSS feels about altered sexuality. It is not a crime. As one of its leading light announced last year, only to deplore it as a socially immoral act and a psychological case in the same breath.
The Manusmriti, which dates back to 1800 years, is a code of conduct for Brahmins riddled with casteist and misogynist sentiments.
Look at Manusmriti 193. As the Brahmana sprang from Brahman's mouth, as he was the firstborn, and as he possesses the Veda, he is by right the lord of this whole creation. Here, Brahman by right becomes the lord of this whole creation. This is the reason the RSS founded by Peshwa Brahman wants Manusmriti in place of constitution. In the eye of constitution, everyone is equal. Brahman by right cannot become the lord of this whole creation. Dear viewers of Gnani's World, let us see what is going to be the fate of Shudras and women.
How loyal the RSS is to the Constitution of India can be known by the following statement of Golwalkar, which is being reproduced from Bunch of Thought, Sahitya Sindhu, Bangalore 1996, page 237 and 238, which is not only selection of the writings of Golwalkar but also a Bible for the RSS cadres.
Golwalkar writes, "Our constitution too is just a cumbersome and heterogeneous piecing together of various articles from various constitutions of Western countries. It has absolutely nothing which can be called our own. Is there a single word of reference in its guiding principles as to what our national mission is and what our keynote in life is?"
In fact, RSS wanted this constitution to be replaced by Manusmriti or Manu Code or Laws of Manu, which is known for its derogatory and inhuman references to Shudras, untouchables and women. The Constituent Assembly of India finalized the Constitution of India on November 26, 1949. RSS was not happy. Its organizer in an editorial on November 30, 1949 complained,
"But in our constitution, there is no mention of the unique constitutional development in ancient Bharat. Manu's laws were written long before Lycurgus of Sparta or Solon of Persia."
To this day, his laws as enunciated in the Manusmriti excite the admiration of the world and elicit spontaneous obedience and conformity. But to our constitutional pundits, that means nothing.
By demanding promulgation of laws of Manu in an independent India, RSS was simply following its mentor, philosopher and guide V.D. Savarkar. According to him,
Manusmriti in that scripture which is most worshipable after Vedas for our Hindu nation and which from ancient times has become the basis of our culture, customs, thoughts and practice. This book from centuries had codified the spiritual and divine march of our nation. Even today, the rules which are followed by crores of Hindus in their lives and practice are based on Manusmriti. We can see the statement of Savarkar in the book of V.D. Savarkar, Women in Manusmriti, in Savarkar Samagra, collections of Savarkar's writings in Hindi. Volume 4, Prabhat, Delhi 2000, page 416.
K.R. Malkani, a leading ideologue of the RSS, admits in his book The RSS Story that Golwalkar, the second supremo of the RSS, saw no reason why Hindu law should break its ancient links with the Manusmriti.
Today, what kind of civilization the RSS and Hindutva camp want to build by enforcing the laws of Manu can be known by having a glimpse of the laws prescribed by Manu for the Shudras and women.
Dear viewers of Gnani's World, keep in mind that we are speaking here about Shudras and not about Dalits or untouchables. Here are some of these dehumanizing and degenerate laws which are presented here as self-explanatory.
This Hindu law book is more like a torture manual for the low caste. The Purusha Sukta is often cited as a proof for caste system. When you quote Manusmriti, Hindus would reject it outright and they would say that we do not believe it anymore.
The question really is not about whether Hindus read it or not. It's about how Hindu religion degrades Shudras and Dalits. There's a statue of Manu in the premises of Rajasthan High Court.
Laws of Manu concerning Shudras. Manusmriti, Chapter 1, Verse 31, Creation of the Brahmana and Other Castes. With a view to the development of the three regions, he brought into existence the Brahmana, the Kshatriya, the Vaishya and the Shudra, out of his mouth, arms, thighs and feet respectively.
Manu writes that it was God who assigned specific professions to those who came out from his mouth, chest, thighs and feet.
Manusmriti 1.87. For the preservation of all this creation, he of great effulgence laid down separate duties for those originations from his mouth, Brahmanas, from his arms, Kshatriyas, from his thighs, Vaishyas, and from his legs, Shudras.
First, Brahmins originated from his mouth, Shudras, from his feet, and then he gave them specific professions. In Manusmriti, Shudras and Chandalas are given capital punishments for committing certain crimes, whereas a Brahmin is given very less punishment, like paying fine or performing penance. Let us have a look at some more verses.
Manusmriti 8.4.13 and 4.14. A Shudra, whether bought or unbought, must serve the Brahmin, a slave purchased or otherwise, must be employed in service as much as it for serving the Brahmana, that he has been created by the self-begotten one. Even set at liberty by his master, a Shudra cannot be liberated from service. Service is his vocation by nature. Who shall emancipate him from that?
Manusmriti 8.4.17. Let a Brahmana unhesitatingly appropriate to himself whatever his Shudra slave has earned, inasmuch as nothing can be belonged to the latter, he being himself an enjoyable good for the Brahmana.
Manusmriti 10.1.29. No collection of wealth must be made by a Shudra, even though he be able to do it. For a Shudra who had acquired wealth gives pain to Brahmanas.
Manusmriti 8.4.18. The king should carefully compile Vaishyas and Shudras to perform the work prescribed for them. For if these two castes swerve from their duties, they would throw this whole world into confusion.
Manusmriti 8.2.81 and 2.82. A low caste man who tries to place himself on the same seat with a man of high caste shall be branded on his hip and be banished, or the king shall cause his buttock to be gashed. If out of arrogance he spits on the superior, the king shall cause both his lips to be cut off. If he urinates on him, the penis. If he breaks wind against him, the anus.
Manusmriti 8:279-80. With whatever limb a man of a low caste does to hurt a man of the three highest castes, even that limb shall be cut off. That is the teaching of Manu. He who raises his hand or a stick shall have his hand cut off. He who in anger kicks with his foot shall have his foot cut off.
Manusmriti 4:61. Let him, that is Brahmin, not dwell in a country where the rulers are Shudras. Manusmriti 4:80. Let him, that is Brahmin, not give to a Shudra advice, nor the remnants of his meal, nor food offered to the gods, nor let him explain the sacred law to such a man, nor impose upon him a penance.
Manusmriti 11:132. Having killed a cat, an ichneumon, a blue jay, a frog, a dog, an iguana, an owl, or a crow, he, that Brahmin, shall perform the penance for the murder of a Shudra.
As per the Manu code, if Shudras are to be given most stringent punishments for even petty violations or actions, the same code of Manu is very lenient towards Brahmins. Shloka 380 in chapter 8, bestowing profound love on Brahmins, decrees, let him never slay a Brahmana, though he have committed all possible crimes. Let him banish such an offender, leaving all his property to him and his body unhurt.
For RSS, casteism is synonymous with Hindu nation. Faith of RSS Brass and Manusmriti, naturally leading them to believe in casteism too. For RSS, casteism is the essence of Hindu nationalism. Golwalkar did not mince words in declaring that casteism was synonymous with Hindu nation.
According to Golwalkar, Bunch of Thoughts, page 36 and 37, the Hindu people are no one else but the Hindu people, they said, is the Virat Purusha, the Almighty manifesting himself. Though they did not use the word Hindu, it is clear from the following description of the Almighty in Purusha Sukta, wherein it is stated that the sun and the moon are his eyes. The stars and the skies are created from his nabi, that is navel, and Brahman is the head, Kshatriya the hands, Vaishya the thighs, and Shudras the feet. This means that the people who have this fourfold arrangement, that is the Hindu people, is just as our God. The supreme vision of Godhead is the very core of a concept of nation and has permeated our thinking and given rise to various unique concepts of our cultural heritage.
Dear viewers of Jnani's World, let us see the laws of Manu concerning women. Manusmriti 9:2. During the day and night, women should not be left to themselves by their men. If they become addicted to sensual objects, they should be kept under one's control. Manusmriti 9:3. The father guards her during virginity, the husband guards her in youth, the son guards her in the old age, the woman is never fit for independence.
Manusmriti 9:18. For women, there is no dealing with the sacred texts, such as the rule of the law. The fact is that being destitute of organs and devoid of sacred texts, women are false. Manusmriti 2:2-13. It is the very nature of women to corrupt men. It is for this reason that the wise are never unguarded regarding women.
Manusmriti 9:96. Women were created for the purpose of childbearing and men for the purpose of procreation. Hence, it is that religious rites have been ordained in the Vedas as common between the man and his wife.
Reproduced parts of Manu code need no further elaboration and commentary. They are too glaringly venomous, fascist, and degenerated against untouchables who are referred to as Shudras by Manu.
Perhaps this was the reason that the German philosopher Friedrich Nietzsche, who contributed immensely to the growth of the totalitarian ideas in Europe in 20th century, fell in love with this work.
With the rise of Hindutva politics in the Hindi heartland, there is a flood of low-priced editions of Manusmriti. In one of such editions by one of the biggest publishers of pocketbooks in Hindi, the back cover has the following glorification of Manusmriti. The Manusmriti is the oldest social system of the world which establishes constitution and justice. Largely, the social and judicial systems of today's India are modeled after this book. It is an essential book for each family, organization and society. Manusmriti Hindi, Sadhana, Delhi, 1999.
Such publishers remain unconcerned about the poison and hatred which Manusmriti contains and convey against the Shudras, untouchables and women.
There seems to be an inherent relationship between the mass publications of such books with increasing violence against the lower caste and women in the country and the rise of Hindu right. It is high time that the nation realizes that the RSS and Hindu rights dream of recreating the golden past is fraught with terrible dangers. Whatever it may be, saying about the Muslims and Christians posing dangers as minorities, it may end up depriving the Hindu Shudras and all women of all their human rights.
Their love for the scriptures like Manusmriti only underline the fact that the real target are the Shudras and women of the Hindu society.
The story does not end with Manusmriti. The RSS bookstores stock and sell titles like How to Lead a Household Life by Swami Ramsukh Das, which openly preach violence. This title is part of low-priced anti-women literature published by Geeta Press.
Here is a glimpse from this book, which is in the question-answer form and available in English, Hindi and other regional Indian languages. What should the wife do if her husband beats her and troubles her?
The wife should think that she is paying her debt of her previous life and thus her sins are being destroyed and she is becoming pure. When her parents come to know this, they can take her to their own house because they have not given their daughter training to face this sort of bad behavior.
What should she do if her parents do not take her to their own house?
Under such circumstances, what can the helpless wife do? She should reap the fruit of her past actions. She should patiently bear the beatings of her husband. By bearing them, she will be freed from her sins and it is possible that her husband may start loving her. Ramsukh Das Swami, How to Lead a Household Life, Geeta Press, Gorakhpur, 1999.
There is blatant preaching in the favor of the inhuman sati as we see in the following. Is sati prata, such as the tradition of the wife being cremated with the dead body of the husband on the funeral pyre, proper or improper?
A wife's cremation with the dead body of her husband on the funeral pyre is not a tradition. She, in whose mind truth and enthusiasm come, burns even without fire and she does not suffer any pain while she burns. This is not a tradition that she should do so, but this is her truth, righteousness and faith in scriptural decorum. Ramsukh Das Swami, How to Lead a Household Life, Geeta Press, Gorakhpur, 1999.
It is to be noted here that a copy of Manusmriti was burnt as a protest in the presence of Dr. B.R. Ambedkar during historic Mahad agitation on December 25th, 1927. Dear viewers of Gnani's World, everything is in front of you in black and white. Identify the real face of the RSS.
Next in Season 3, Know About the RSS? Episode 4, we will see, does RSS have faith in democracy, secularism and federalism? So follow us on Facebook, Twitter and Instagram. Kindly subscribe to the channel and press bell icon for further updates. Thank you.